الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، we continue with العقيدة الوسطية للشيخ الإسلام بن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى والدشرح بشيخ محمد بن صالح بن عثيمين. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى bestow His mercy upon him in his grave and make him among his righteous servants in the life to come. وعليكم السلام. أهلا. طيب، we had been dealing actually with the idea that Allah Azza wa Jal is above the creation. Furthermore, Waalaikum Salaam, we had quoted a number of evidences to support this position held by Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And we, the Shaykh himself, Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, had introduced what we call in Arabic a shubha. A shubha is what?
Doubt.
Right? It could be a misconception. In some contexts, shubha can mean misconception. Sometimes when they want to translate misconceptions about Islam, they say shubuhatun hawla al-Islam, right? But the more usual meaning for shubha is doubtful matter, in particular, something doubtful. And there's a doubt of the expression, or we said the preposition fi. Remember? Fi, as a preposition, said, we said it means what in English? In. And we have verses in the Quran saying that Allah is fis-sama, suggesting one way or another, if we're going to take it face value, that the heavens encompass Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or that it's, you know, in means in. However, we explained that there are two possible explanations. First, which we dealt with, was the fact that we said fis sama, meaning in the state of transcendency, meaning above. And we quoted evidences that Allah said that rain comes down from the sama, and we know that rain comes down from the clouds, and the sama is even beyond that. And the Shaykh rahimahullah had mentioned the explanation for that, that it comes from a place between the heavens and the earth, and not necessarily the sama itself, which is a ceiling for this, you know, earth of ours, or let's say this for this earth as far as we know. And then, you know, what's beyond that is what's beyond that. It's Allah's knowledge from the sab' samawat, the seven heavens. And أَوْ نَجْعَلْ فِي بِمَعْنَى عَلَى, or we make fi equal in meaning to عَلَى, which means really means on. But however, I would prefer to use the preposition above, because linguistically speaking, the common meaning of the preposition on is being on top of something along with the existence of contact. Okay? So I say the phone is on the table. However, if I said that the light or the air conditioner is above my head, this indicates being on top of something with a gap in distance. You follow me? So the AC, I don't say the AC is on me, because if I said the AC is on me, what comes to mind is that it's on my head. If I say it's above me, meaning it's above me, however there's a space. Very important. Because if we say on, that may suggest that Allah Azza wa Jal is, يعني, there's contact with the throne, and we don't have anything in the Quran and Sunnah, as far as I know, to confirm that. So we don't want to give any meaning which is not suggested in the Quran and the Sunnah. So if we say is above, it's just above. The exact reality of that, Allahu Ta'ala alam. But on is specifies the meaning which we do not want. You follow me? So even though ala is usually translated as on, but in fact it could be ala, on or above, in the English language as a preposition versus the harf al-jar in Arabic. وَنَجْعَلُ السَّمَاءَ هِيَ السَّقْفُ الْمَحْفُوظِ الْمَرْفُوعِ يعني الأجرام السماوية. And we will make the heaven, excuse me, the ceiling, the ceiling which is high above. وتأتي في بمعنى على في اللغة العربية. And furthermore, في does give, does have the meaning of على or above, as I said now, in the Arabic language. نَي بل في القرآن الكريم. But even in the noble Quran. قال فرعون لقومه السحر الذين آمنوا ولأصلبنكم في جذوع النخل. فرعون said to the magicians who had embraced Islam, huh? Who submitted to Allah upon seeing the miracles that Allah Azza wa Jalla had bestowed upon Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and that in that challenge that took place between him and the magicians, they believed immediately. Fir'aun threatened them by saying la usallibannakum is like a verb that is in the future, it's a future tense, and it also suggests affirming emphasis with this la usallibannakum, I shall surely crucify you, from salib, salb. وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ, remember in the previous ayah, وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ, they neither crucified Jesus nor they killed him. صَلَبُوهُ لَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ I shall crucify you. Now here, see in the trunks of the palm, the date palm tree. Is that possible? We said it's impossible. Can you crucify someone inside a tree? Is the tree in such a way where you can open it up, crucify someone and close it back up? Has this ever happened? What is intended here? Ala, on. You'll be crucified on the tree for the people to see you as an example for them. But the word that Allah Azza wa Jal chose to use in this ayah and other occasions is fi, which means what? That fi does not necessarily mean in. It could mean on or above. Alhamdulillah. أي على جذوع النخل فيكون معنى من في السماء أي من على السماء. So then what is intended here? The one who is above the heavens. No problem. ولا إشكال بعد هذا. We have no problem after that. So alhamdulillah that we're able to refute them with references from the Quran. Because if we were just to give them the Arabic language, it's debatable. But when we say, look, Allah used fi in this context with this meaning, then they have to be silent. If Allah used it, خلاص. It's game over, as they say. فإن قلت كيف نجم كيف تجمع بين هذه الآية وبين قوله تعالى وهو الذي في السماء إله وفي الأرض إله وقوله وهو الله في السماوات وفي الأرض يعلم سركم وجهركم. If someone says, how do you then bring a relation between the verse which we are dealing with and these verses of Allah, these two verses in the Quran where Allah says, and it is He who is the only إله in the heavens and the only إله on the earth. And another ayah, and it is Allah in the heavens and on the earth. He knows your secret and that which is evident and clear to the people. That which you can see and that which is obvious. So how do we bring a relation between both? Because the ayah says, and it is, you know, وَهُوَ الَّذِي فِي السَّمَاءِ إِلَهِ. He is in the heavens, the ilah, and on earth, an ilah. So what does that suggest? That Allah Azza wa Jal is also on earth because it's the ilah. Now a time out, don't get confused. فالجواب أن نقول أما الآية الأولى فإن الله يقول وهو الذي في السماء إله وفي الأرض إله. Notice now the wording. It is He who is in the heavens, the ilah. What does ilah mean?
Two.
Ilah means two?
Ilah, God.
Right? Al-Ilah. No, Ilah, God. Al-Ilah, the God. And this is where we get Allah from, which is the true God. So it becomes Allah, right? Which is really Al-Ilah, initially. Right. فالظرف هنا لألوهيته. The preposition here, meaning in the heavens, is for the ilahiyya of Allah, the uluhiyya of Allah, meaning the only one who deserves to be worshipped. Not the physical being, not the being himself, right? Rather the fact that he is the one worshipped, he is worshipped in the heavens among the angels, and he is worshipped on earth among the creation, the jinn and mankind. يعني أن ألوهيته ثابتة في السماء والأرض, meaning his uluhiyya, him being the only one deserving of worship, is established in the heavens and on the earth. كما تقول فلان أمير في المدينة ومكة, like you say, such person is the prince of Medina and Mecca. Now وهو في نفسه في واحدة منهما, however he is in Mecca now. Is it applicable to say هو الأمير في المدينة ومكة? Isn't it right? No? يعني for him to be an أمير مكة مدينة has to cut himself in two pieces, put one half in مدينة one half in مكة. يا شيخ. A person, maybe I confused you in my question. Let me rephrase my statement. We say فلان هو الأمير في المدينة ومكة. He's the أمير in مدينة and مكة. In. Does he have to be in both places simultaneously to be the أمير? No, he can be in China. He's the أمير. You get me? So his position of prince, being a prince, is established in Mecca and Medina. His existence, his physical being, his being is irrelevant. This is the context. So Allah is the Ilah, the one worshipped in the heavens, among the angels, in the earth. And not that Allah Azza wa Jalla himself is there. Otherwise, if someone makes that claim, that is contradicting the clear verses in the Quran. This is impossible that the Quran will contradict itself. Right or wrong? So the one who said, أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ cannot come and say that he is both in the heavens and the earth after he told you, do you feel secure that he who is above the heavens? Otherwise it becomes contradiction. So we understand these verses in the light of the other verses. Which is clearer in indication? The first, do you feel secure that he who is above the heavens will cause the earth to tremble? Versus this one. It's obvious that this one, the interpretation is that إله, meaning the one who's being worshipped. Right. جميل. وفيهما جميعا بإمارته وسلطته. So the Amir will be the Amir of both locations, even though he may be in one of them only at a particular time. But however, his authority, his authority is established in both places. فالله تعالى أولوهيته في السماء وفي الأرض وأما هو عز وجل ففي السماء. So Allah's uluhiyya, meaning the divinity, right? The attribute of being the only one deserving of being worshipped is established in the heavens and the earth. However, Allah Himself is above the heavens. Clear? Beautiful. وأما الآية الثانية وهو الله في السماوات وفي الأرض. As for the other ayah, He is Allah in the heavens and on earth. فنقول فيها كما قلنا في التي قبلها. We say about this what we said about the previous verse. وهو الله أي هو الإله الذي ألوهيته في السماء وفي الأرض. في السماوات وفي الأرض. It is his uluhiyya, the state of being the only one who is deserving of worship is established in the heavens and in the earth. أما هو نفسه فهو ففي السماء. As for Allah himself, he is above the heavens. فيكون المعنى هو المألوه في السماوات والمألوه في الأرض فألوهيته في السماوات وفي الأرض. Is that clear? It is him being deserving of being worshipped that is established in the heavens and in the earth. Now interestingly enough, had this been something that Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah alaykum salam were scared of, they wouldn't quote it here. They would expect the masses of Muslims alaykum salam to be ignorant. So no mention alaykum salam, no mention of this would be made. But you see Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they're confident. So much so that the Shaykh will present to you other doubts. He will present to you other verses that may seem confusing and refute them instantly. Why? Because the matter is clear. And anybody who brings a different understanding is deviating. And this is all trying to go into the basic understanding. Taking it back to the righteous predecessors, the Sahaba read these verses, they had no such interpretation that entailed that Allah is everywhere. So for someone to derive this kind of meaning is unacceptable. Because if you go back to the tafsir of Ibn Abbas and the Mufassirin among the Sahaba and the later generations of the Tabi'in, you find that they had no such references, no such understandings derived from these verses. So anyone who tries to produce this kind of understanding from these verses and evidence, we say, do you know more of tafsir than the Sahaba? Are you more knowledgeable of the Arabic language than the early generations? Impossible. Impossible for you to deduce a meaning that they did not understand. So this is deviance. You see what I'm saying? But now what the Shaykh is dealing with it, with this understood. Still, in the very verse that they're trying to present as a doubt, there's no room for that. It's refutable. And we have done so, alhamdulillah. جيد. فتخريج هذه الآية كتخريج التي قبلها. قبلها عفوا. وقيل المعنى هو الله في السماوات ثم تقف ثم تقرأ وفي الأرض يعلم سركم وجهركم. أي أنه نفسه في السماوات ويعلم سركم وجهركم في الأرض فليس كونه في السماء معلوه بمانع من علمه بسركم في الأرض. This is a weak interpretation that the Sheikh quoted that could be used, but he said then بَهَذَا فِي شَيْءٍ مِنَ الضَّعْفِ. This is weak, where you stop the ayah. Say, and it is Allah who is above the heavens, and you pause. Then you say, and on earth He knows your secret and that which you reveal. And he said, but this is weak, and we don't have to go through that in order to prove anything. So we leave that alone. من الفوائد المسلكية من هذه الآيات في هذه الآيات أن الإنسان إذا علم بأن الله تعالى فوق كل شيء فإنه يعرف مقدار سلطانه وسيطرته على خلقه وحينئذ يخافه ويعظمه وإذا خاف الإنسان ربه وعظمه فإنه يتقيه ويقوم بالواجب ويدع المحرم. The practical benefits which we derive from these ayat is that if the individual knows that Allah Azza wa Jal is above everything, and that then he knows he recognizes the extent of the authority of Allah Azza wa Jal over his creation, and then thereby the servant will fear Allah and he will magnify him. And if the human being fears his Lord and he magnifies him, then he will have taqwa of him. He will avoid disobeying him by fulfilling the commandments and staying away from the prohibitions. وَيَقُومُ بِالْوَاجِبُ وَيَدَعَ الْمُحَرَّمُ. So he fulfills the obligations and leaves alone the prohibitions. This is what is the practical benefit of knowing that. That you know, if Allah Azza wa Jalla, somebody sent me an email, I believe today, some email about the our planet, right? Our planet, the Earth, in comparison to Jupiter and some other planets. And then he went on to, you know, to go beyond that, to the galaxies, to the sun. And anyways, if you keep looking, we turn out to be nothing. I mean, the whole Earth will be invisible in the vast galaxies, and which this is what we have discovered, you know, thus far with the telescopes and so on and so forth. Don't ask about and spaceships. Don't ask about what is beyond that, which we have not discovered yet, that may exist. So this is the vastness of the creation, right? And we are like nothing. This whole earth is like nothing. And then we on this earth are even less than nothing. And Allah Azza wa Jal is greater than all that, right? He observes, He sees, right? So that should make you what? Fear Allah. When you want to disobey Him, you think twice before you engage in some sort of sin. Then you realize that Allah has such authority over you that you're nothing. If He wishes, the earth will open up and swallow you, just like it happened to Qarun. And no one will be able to do anything for you. Not the president, not the family, not the chief. No one will come and intercede for you. Nothing can be done for you. Not in the dunya, not in the life to come. No one can come and say, Ma'lish, this guy, you know, Mia Mia. Please, you know, give him a special treatment. No one will come on a special chair on the Day of Judgment. Everybody will come the same. The king and the peasant will be naked, uncircumcised and barefooted. The highest person in the, you know, in the state, and the least one will come on the Day of Judgment equal on the side of Allah, right? And no one will be getting his bodyguards with him or any, you know, special privileges, nothing of this nature. So this is our final destination. Inshallah ta'ala will bring this to mind on daily basis. We have finished the most crucial or one of the most crucial aspects of the belief system of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah concerning Allah's transcendency and Allah's being above the throne subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner which befits His majesty. And now we're going into a very delicate matter, the issue of ma'iyyah. Ma'iyyah comes from, it has to do with the preposition ma'. What does ma' mean? With? Who agrees? ذهب أحمد مع محمد إلى المدرسة. With. You said it right. I was hoping I get some confirmation here. مع is with. Being with. معية obviously is derived from this preposition مع, which is the state of being with. And because of this because of this attribute of Allah, many Muslims have went astray. Not because of the attribute, I'm sorry, because of their misunderstanding of this attribute of Allah, they went far astray and practically all of the individuals who believe that Allah is everywhere, right? And that Allah is mixed with this creation, at the end of the day, believe so because of their misunderstanding and their misconceptions concerning the quality of ma'iyyah, which is found in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So it is very important that we understand this, these coming classes, because with the understanding of these classes, we will be really able to deliver the Aqidah of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Because you may explain everything I explained to you earlier, or the Shaykh explained to us earlier, then they will give you a verse from the Quran dealing with ma'iyyah, and you will not be able to say anything else if you don't know. So this is very crucial that we learn this. Alhamdulillah, it is very logical. There's nothing sophisticated about it. It's just a matter of understanding it correctly. And the Shaykh, inshallah, will do a wonderful job in doing so. Ma'iyya, meem, ayn, ya, ta, marbuta. Ma'iyya. Of course, it's written ma'iyya with ta. Ta, marbuta, with two dots. However, when in the Arabic language, when you want to stop at that word, or you want to read it on its own, you don't pronounce the ta. It becomes a ha. So, zakah, salah, and so on and so forth. طيب. إثبات معية الله لخلقه. Affirming Allah's being with, I'm going to use that terminology, ma'alish, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His creation. Allah being with His creation. How do we understand that? شرح المؤلف رحمه الله بسوق أدلة المعية أي أدلة معية الله تعالى لخلقه. The author رحمه الله initiated quoting the evidences of for ma'iyya. I'm just going to use ma'iyya, and remember it means being with the creation. Being with the creation. Okay? So I will not have to repeat this 100 times. وناسب أن يذكرها بعد العلو. And it was convenient that he makes mention of that after mentioning علو. After finishing transcendency, he deals with the chapter now or the idea of ma'iyya. لأنه قد يبدو للإنسان أن هناك تناقضا بين كونه فوق كل شيء وكونه مع العباد. Because it may seem contradictory that Allah Azza wa Jal is above everything, however He is with the servants. Right or wrong? Doesn't it seem? How is Allah above the creation? However He is with the creation. فكان من المناسب جدا أن يذكر الآيات التي تثبت معية الله للخلق بعد ذكر آيات العلو. So it was very wise and practical and convenient that he mentions these ayat after mentioning the ulu. Now before we go there, let me hear you out. I want to see where your brother stand, you know, before we really go into this. This is a pop quiz, they call it. Have you ever had pop quizzes before? Now the grading here is very tough, my grading system. If you don't know the answer, I will do absolutely nothing. So inshallah you don't have to worry about my grading system. Let's see, who can give us possible explanations, but on the condition that A, you have never read anything concerning this, you don't have any background on this issue. We will begin with those, right? If we don't find anyone who has, you know, who doesn't have any answers, then we will go to someone who's read upon this issue before. But first, those who've never read about this, you've only been dealing with this class, this is all news to you, right? You didn't even know what Aqidah meant beforehand. And now you're learning all this information, and you have this dilemma now. We're saying that Allah is above His creation, we proved that in so many different ways, then all of a sudden we're telling you Allah is with His creation. Logically, how would you refute that? Or how would you understand that? Hi, Amudir.
I don't know. I guess He just knows what you're doing.
Okay.
So
with means He knows?
Not necessarily. Maybe in Salah, I guess.
Huh?
Maybe in Salah, I guess.
Maybe in Salah. You still remember the lecture, huh? Well, I mean, you got a point there. Can anyone help or build on this information?
He is with you with His knowledge.
He is with you
with His knowledge.
With His knowledge. This is your explanation. Anything else?
With you mean that it's with you when you are worshipping Him. That means in the Salah, when we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, Whenever you recite, he is responding.
Yeah, but does that mean ma'iyya though?
It's with your prayer, with worship, whatever worship.
Allah, in this sense that Allah is always with you, in the sense because anything you do, Allah is knowledgeable of it. Yeah, so that, sweet.
It doesn't mean that Allah is physically with you. It is by knowledge only Allah is with you. And also if you are, for example, if you are calling back home, just to give support, if you say, I am with you, don't worry, we are telling you. It doesn't mean that physically we are present there.
Hey, you heard this one from me, man. You can't be giving my own information, Ibrahim. That's fine though. Well, actually this is problematic. Because of the fact that your explanation, even though it's very popular, that it is, they say it's Allah's knowledge, ability, and so on and so forth that is with you, and not the physical being. Even though this is a very popular explanation, it does trap us, in a sense. Because the people, Asha'ira, Mu'tazila, and the likes, whom we had already been criticizing for explaining away the apparent meaning of the verse, for giving it, you know, another ta'wil, another interpretation, they say you are preventing us from doing that, however you are falling into the same thing. The verse says Allah is with you, and you're saying Allah's knowledge is with you. And this is the same thing that you did not allow us to do in the other verses, in the other qualities. So even though this is a very popular explanation, it does trap us. And this is why you find Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, the Shaykh al-Islam, had a much better refutation that does not allow, that does not make us, you know, become trapped in this particular position, wherein we have to, you know, say, oh, okay, no, but no, we don't need that. We have something strong enough to say, no, Allah is with the creation. And not only with His knowledge, and not only with this, and we will prove how that can exist logically, linguistically, and through the Quran. So are you ready for this roller coaster, inshallah? Yeah. Don't fall asleep. Okay. وفي معية الله تعالى لخلقه مباحث. المبحث الأول في أقسامها. Now there are excuse me, a number of discussions that we will be elaborating on when it comes to the issue of معية. The first of which, المبحث الأول في أقسامها, معية الله عز وجل تنقسم إلى قسمين, عامة وخاصة. First, Allah's معية is divided into two main categories. Number one, عامة,
general.
Number two, خاصة, specific. Beautiful. Let's use these translations. والخاصة تنقسم إلى قسمين. العامة is one. خاصة, specific, is further divided into two subcategories. So first, عامة, general. That's one. خاصة is another category on its own, and itself is divided into two more subcategories. بشخص, مقيد بشخص, ومقيد بوصف. A specific type which is specific to a person, and the other one specific to an attribute. Okay, specific to a person, ma'iyya, specific to an individual, and ma'iyya, specific to an attribute which an individual may possess. Right? You follow me? We will see what that means. Just write the headlines, inshallah, or the headings, and it will be clear. أما العامة, as for the general ma'iyya of Allah, فهي تشمل كل أحد من مؤمن وكافر وبر وفاجر. And this is why the explanation of the salah is weak. The general ma'iyya of Allah includes everyone, the believer and the disbeliever, the righteous and the wicked. Allah is with all of them. ودليلها قوله تعالى وهو معكم أينما كنتم. The evidence for that is the statement of Allah, and He is with you wherever you may be. So that statement in the Quran, this is Surah Al-Hadid, verse 4, entails generalization. He is with you wherever you may be. That includes everything. You follow me? Beautiful. This is the Amma. Don't worry. We will answer all that. أما الخاصة, what is the first subcategory of a khassa?
Specific type.
to what? The first one to a person. أما الخاصة المقيدة ب... But the Shaykh began with the wasf. معلش. So we deal with the Shaykh's breakdown. So he first he said it is specific to a person. Then he said second type is specific to a attribute or a quality. He would begin with the second. Specific to a quality. فمثل قوله تعالى إن الله مع الذين اتقوا والذين هم محسنون. سورة النحل verse 128. Verily Allah is with those who have taqwa and those who are among the good doers. المحسنون those who are good doers. So here it's specific to what? The people of taqwa and the people of ihsan. So now this the Allah's ma'iyya is specific to an attribute. Any person who has taqwa and ihsan, there's a specific kind of ma'iyya between him and Allah Azza wa Jal. You follow me? Did anyone get lost on the way? You're on the track. طيب. If you get lost, raise your hand. طيب. First then the quality. طيب. وأما الخاصة المقيدة بشخص معين. As for the specific one, which is specified to a particular individual, فمثل قوله تعالى عن نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم إذ يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن إن الله معنا. This is equal or similar to the statement or the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq while they were in the cave hiding from the mushrikeen, do not grieve, verily Allah is ma'ana, with us. So now it's specific to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wa arda. So specific ma'iyya for quality, taqi, a person who fears Allah. Muhsin, a person who is a good doer. That's general. Particular individuals, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. طيب. وهذا أخص من المقيد بالوصف. This is more specific than the one that is specific to a quality, because it is specific to individuals themselves. Beautiful. فالمعية درجات. So then we go. The Shaykh will mention or summarize what he mentioned. عامة مطلقة. General, encompassing everything. وخاصة مقيدة بوصف. Specific, particular to a quality. وخاصة مقيدة بشخص. Specific, particular to an individual. We're on the same page. جميل. فأخص أنواع المعية ما قيد بشخص. Which is the most specific among them? To a particular individual. Right? Versus a quality. Because when you say Allah is with the muttaqeen, there may be thousands of them. But a particular individual is the most specific of all. طيب. ثم ما قيد بوصف ثم ما كان عاما. طيب. فالمعية العامة تستلزم الإحاطة بالخلق علما وقدرة وسمعا وبصرا وسلطانا وغير ذلك من معاني ربوبيته. والمعية الخاصة بنوعيها تستلزم مع ذلك النصر والتأييد. Now we have a general understanding here, which is around what you brothers were revolving around, is the fact that the general ma'iyya necessitates Allah's encompassment of the creation in terms of knowledge, in terms of ability, in terms of hearing, in terms of seeing, and in terms of authority and other of that from Allah's lordship, attributes of lordship. And the specific ma'iyya includes all of the aforementioned along with nasr and ta'eed, aid and support. Aid and support. This is the first mabhath, the first discussion. Al-mabhath al-thani, the second discussion, this is the vital one. هل المعية حقيقية؟ هل المعية حقيقية أو هي كناية عن علم الله عز وجل وسمعه وبصره وقدرته وسلطانه وغير ذلك من معاني ربوبيته. Is this معية? Is it real? Or is it a metaphor? It's a metaphor, or there's another word I'm looking for, not the simile. Subhanallah al-Azim. Is it something actual? Right, whatever. Is it real, or it's like symbolic? Let's say it's symbolic, or it symbolizes, there you go, it symbolizes Allah's ability, hearing, seeing, knowledge, and so forth. Which one is it? This is the discussion I presented to you earlier. Now the Shaykh says, أكثر عبارات السلف, رحمهم الله يقولون أنها كناية عن العلم وعن السمع والبصر والقدرة وما أشبه ذلك. Most of the expressions of the Salaf, our righteous predecessors, may Allah have mercy on him, on them, indicate that it symbolizes knowledge, hearing, seeing, and ability, as you brothers had yourselves explained earlier. وما أشبه ذلك. فيجعلون معنى قوله هو معكم أي وهو عالم بكم، سميع لأقوالكم، بصير بأعمالكم، قادر عليكم، حاكم بينكم، وهكذا فيفسرونها بلازمها. So they say that the meaning of and he is with you, that is, he is knowing of everything, hearing all of your statements, seeing all of your actions, able to do anything he wants to you, and he's the judge between you and so forth. So they explain it in this particular fashion. واختار شيخ الإسلام رحمه الله في هذا الكتاب وغيره أنها على حقيقتها. And Shaykh al-Islam, may Allah have mercy on him, chose in this book and other books of his and other things he authored that it is according to its real meaning, that Allah is with us. It's like suspense. Remember this guy Alfred Hitchcock? Good. You don't have to remember him. Silly movies. But supposedly it was supposed to be all suspense. طيب. Now this is interesting, man. I'm just so excited. وَأَنَّ كَوْنَهُ مَعْنَا حَقًّا عَلَى حَقِيقَتِهِ. And the fact that Allah is with us is something that is true. We don't explain it away. We don't say, no, it's Allah's knowledge. No, it means it's Allah's ability. No, it means Allah's hearing, seeing. No. In fact, however, it's coming. لَكِنْ لَيْسَتْ مَعِيَّتِهِ كَمَعِيَّةِ الْإِنسَانِ لِلْإِنسَانِ التي يمكن أن يكون الإنسان مع الإنسان في مكانه. However, and this is the most important thing, it is unlike the with being with of the human being to the human being, where when you are with someone, you have to be sitting with him in the same location. Assuming that this is what is intended here. لأن معية الله عز وجل ثابتة له وهو في علوه. Because Allah's transcendency is affirmed to him. I mean, Allah being with his creation is referring to him while he's above his creation. فهو معنى معنى وهو عال على عرشه فوق كل شيء. He is with us while he is above his throne and above everything. How do we understand that? We go back to the very first principle which we have been explaining over and over again. Ya akhi, there's nothing like Allah. There's nothing like Allah. You don't and you can't understand the names and attributes of Allah the same way you understand that of the creation. Once you do that, you are in trouble. Yes, in the creation this is impossible. But with Allah, it's not. Because Allah is unlike His creation. Then the Shaykh will give you a number of evidences. But let me give you just something so you can, you know, as they say, food for the soul. So you will not be too excited for too long. Example. Now, let's say all of you speak to me simultaneously. Am I able to answer all of you simultaneously? Can any human being answer anyone simultaneously? Number of people simultaneously? Impossible. This is what the creation. Type. We have in authentic narrations that the Prophet ﷺ said that when a slave of Allah is in the state of Salah and he's reciting the Fatiha and he says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah replies to him and says, Hamidani Abdi, my servant has praised me. When he says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah says, Athna Alayya Abdi, my servant has glorified me, until the end of the ayah, the surah. Type. In one particular location, only one masjid, how many people are reciting the Fatiha? Five, six rows. Are they all saying it simultaneously? No. This brother is still Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. This one is already saying Wala Dalleen Ameen. Right? Yes, I mean they all recite the Fatiha. But are they at the same verse? No. Now does Allah reply to each and every one? Yes. He does. Yes. Because that's what the hadith says. How? Akhi, there's nothing like Allah. You can do that. But you can try to implement and apply your deficiencies on Allah Azza wa Jal. Yeah, you can be with someone unless you're physically there with them. But with Allah Azza wa Jal, this is possible. So this is one of the ways You see how powerful this is? No one can play with that. This is why it is very important to understand the foundation which we build this understanding of this book on. There is nothing like Allah. Every time they insist on giving us some anthropomorphic understanding which is a human based, we say, listen, you have a problem in your aqidah. You keep insisting that Allah is some human being somewhere whom you can't understand unless you imagine human beings. It doesn't work this way. Because Allah told us and taught us that there's nothing like unto Him. Meaning us human beings are not like Allah. Whatever applies to us does not apply to Him. What applies to Him does not apply to us. The Prophet ﷺ, when he was traveling, he used to say, Allahumma anta sahibu fi safar wal khalifatu fil ahl. Oh Allah, you are the companion during travel and the one who protects my family behind. Can anyone travel with you and protect your family simultaneously? No. He will either remain there protecting your family or he will be traveling with you. But with Allah Azza wa Jal, He is the one who is able to protect your family and be your companion during travel. Again, not in this physical sense that He is there, you know, with the person. You see what I'm saying? So these are some of them. Some of the logical explanations and the textual explanations that cannot be refuted. So we don't have to say, oh no, in His knowledge, and say, no, yeah, yeah, Allah is with. How? Don't ask how, akhi. You can do it, I know. Allah can. And that does not necessitate that He is mixed with His creation. And then we have other arguments for that one. But I will let the Shaykh, rahimahullah, deal with this. Then we will get to this, inshallah. I'm just trying to give you something so you will not go home with some misconceptions, you know, about what we believe. Jayyid. Na'am. فهو معنى أيوة ولا يمكن بأي حال من الأحوال أن يكون معنا في الأمكنة التي نحن فيها. So it is impossible under any circumstance that Allah Azza wa Jal will be with us in the same place where we are. So we go back. When we say Allah is with us, it doesn't mean that Allah Azza wa Jal Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is in this room with us. Right? As in He is mixed with us. He is in the room. This is not what we are intending. Right? He Himself is where? Above His creation. However, the quality of being with exists with Allah. How? In a manner which befits His majesty. However, there is no contradiction between that and the second. He is not physically here as some people may suggest. And we will deal with that inshaAllah ta'ala. جيد. وعلى هذا فإنه يحتاج إلى الجمع بينهما وبين العلو. With that said, then we are expected now to bring a relation between Allah being with and Allah's transcendency. How do we do that? والمؤلف رحمه الله عقد لها فصلا خاصا سيأتي بيانه إن شاء الله تعالى. The author, Shaykh al-Islam, had given or had dedicated a specific chapter dealing only with this issue. How do we bring a relation between Allah being above and being with the creation? This will come later إن شاء الله. وأنه لا منافاة بين العلو والمعية. And that there is no contradiction between transcendency and being with, ma'iyya. لأن الله تعالى ليس كمثل شيء في جميع صفاته, because there is nothing like unto Allah in all of His attributes. فهو علي في دنوه قريب في علوه. He is high above while being near, and He is near while being above. Subhanallah. This is just Allah Azza wa Jal, beyond our imagination. وضرب شيخ الإسلام رحمه الله لذلك مثلا بالقمر. And Shaykh al-Islam رحمه الله struck an example, the example of the moon. قال إنه يقال, it is said, ما زلنا نسير والقمر معنا. Listen to the wordings. We continue to travel while the moon is with us. Isn't the moon with the people? Yes. The moon. While you're traveling, as long as you are able to observe it and see it, isn't it considered to be with you? Does it mean it's in your pocket? Does it mean that you and the moon have to be sitting next to each other in one physical location to say linguistically that the moon is with you? No. This is the example that Ibrahim used, you know, from the ones we have mentioned before. My son is having an exam, or the general of the army standing on the top of the hill. Right, and he has his, you know, walkie-talkie with him. Don't worry, I'm with you. Now, is he with them? He's chilling on the mountain. He got some lemonade, you know. They're the ones who are fighting downstairs. But he is supporting them verbally, linguistically. We say, I am with you. Say, brother, I support you on this issue. I am with you, even though I may be on the phone. When I say I'm with you, meaning I'm with you on this issue, does that mean that I'm physically with you? No. So even when we use ma, this ma being with does not necessitate the physical coexistence of two things at the same time. Because linguistically this is not the case. Is that clear? وَهُوَ مَوْضُوعٌ فِي السَّمَاءِ The moon is in the heaven, is in the sky. However, we say it is with us. وَهُوَ مِنْ أَصْغَرِ الْمَخْلُوقَاتِ And it is among the smallest of the creation. فَكَيْفَ لَا يَكُونُ الْخَالِقُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ مَعَ الْخَلْقِ الَّذِي الْخَلْقُ بِالنِّسْبَةِ إِلَيْهِ لَيْسُ بِشَيْءٍ وَهُوَ فَوْقَ سَمَوَاتِهِ Even though the moon is among the smallest of the creations of Allah compared to the heavens and the sun and the galaxies, and if it's so small, because we are able to see it, or because of this reality, we say the moon is with us, even though it's small. He said, then what about the Creator? Then how can not the Creator be with His creation, even though His creation in comparison to Him are nothing? The whole creation in comparison to Him are nothing while He's above the heavens. So you see the analogy here? The moon is in the heaven, is in the sky. We say the moon is with us. And it's a tiny creation of Allah. But because of this reality, we are able to use the expression إِنَّ الْقَمَرَ مَعَنَا It is with us. If this is the case with something among the creation, then what about the Creator and the creation? How can He not be with them then? You know, even though He's not with them in a sense that He is with them here, mixed. How can it not be that He is above His heavens, above His creation, however He is with them because we are so tiny? You see the point? وَمَا قَالُهُ رَحِمَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ دَفْعُ حُجَّةِ بَعْضَ أَهْلِ التَّعْطِيلِ حَيْثُ احْتَجُّوا عَلَى أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ فَقَالُوا إِنَّكُمْ تَمْنَعُونَ التَّأْوِيلِ وَأَنْتُمْ تُؤَوِّلُونَ فِي الْمَعِيَّةِ The Shaykh said, and what he said, رَحِمَ اللَّهُ, actually is a refutation against the evidence that أَهْلِ التَّعْطِيلِ, the people of denial, use against us, أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ, by saying you disallow, you know, interpreting the verse in a different way than the apparent meaning. However, you do the same thing in ma'iyya, as I explained to you earlier. تقول المعية بمعنى العلم. You say ma'iyya means knowledge, hearing, seeing, وسلطان وما أشبه ذلك, and whatever is of this nature. فنقول إن المعية حق على حقيقته. We say no, ma'iyya is true according to its real meaning, the real meaning of being with. لكنها ليست على المفهوم الذي فهمه الجهمية ونحوهم but it is not as understood by the Jahmites and their likes who wind up necessitating that Allah must be mixed with the creation in a single location بأنه مع الناس في كل مكان that Allah is with the people everywhere so this is where they got this belief system that Allah is everywhere وتفسير بعض السلف لها بالعلم ونحوه تفسير باللازم and the people of the righteous predecessors they explain in this way because that is what is understood that Allah does know, He sees, He hears And this is what was apparent of the word. However, we choose the opinion of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah in order to keep away any other refutations from the Ahlul al-Ta'til who may say, why are you denying or disallowing ta'wil whereas you yourself, you're practicing it. So this is how we refute them with this understanding. طيب, المبحث الثالث هل المعية من الصفات الذاتية أو الصفات الفعلية معية Is it from the personal attributes of Allah We dealt with that before Or is it from the action attributes of Allah
Personal
Personal طب who reminds us Who can remind us about the breakdown of الصفات الذاتية والصفات الفعلية Not a lot of revision, huh? huh, brothers? Anyone? Personal attributes. Personal. Zatiyya. Fa'liyya. Khabariyya. Ibrahim. لسبب معلوم. لسبب غير معلوم. For a known reason.
Unknown.
Action. action, the attributes of action, the action attributes when Allah Azza wa Jal becomes pleased with someone. Right? It's with a reason, we know why. You do good, Allah is pleased with you. Allah descending to the lowest heaven is among the action attributes of Allah. However, we don't know the reason. Active, we said active, not action, I'm sorry. Active attributes of Allah, right? And we said sifatul dhatiyah are the personal attributes of Allah that are consistent, right? Always and forever. You know, unlike like being pleased, Allah is pleased. If someone does something which requires Allah's pleasure, He becomes angry if someone does something which makes Allah Azza wa Jal angry. But sifatul dhatiyah are personal attributes of Allah, such as knowledge, hayat, so on and so forth. Things that are always, is that clear? You forgot. ما في مشكلة. The Shaykh says, فيه تفصيل. We have a breakdown for this. أما المعية العامة فهي ذاتية. The general معية is actually from the personal attributes of Allah. Okay? لأن الله لم يزل ولا يزال محيطا بخلق علما وقدرة وسلطانا وغير ذلك من معاني ربوبيته. Because Allah is forever and always will be encompassing His creation in terms of knowledge, in terms of seeing, in terms of hearing, ability, so on and so forth. وأما المعية الخاصة فهي صفة فعلية. As for the المعية الخاصة, the specific معية, then this is an active attribute of Allah عز وجل. لأنها تابعة لمشيئة الله, because it is conditional to Allah's will. وكل صفة مقرونة بسبب هي من الصفات الفعلية. Every attribute of Allah which is conditional to a reason, a cause, it becomes from the active attributes of Allah. فقد سبق لنا أن الرضا من الصفات الفعلية. We have already explained that رضا, being pleased with, is from the active attributes of Allah. لأنه مقرون بسبب, because it is conditional to a reason. You do this, a cause and effect. Cause and effect. إذا وجد السبب الذي به يرضى الله, if the reason or the cause exists with which Allah عز وجل becomes pleased. وكذلك المعية الخاصة. Similarly, the specific معية. إذا وجدت التقوى, if you have taqwa, then this will bring about Allah's special ma'iyah. Right? On the condition that what? You have taqwa. You see the breakdown? أو غيرها من أسبابها في شخص كان الله معه. Or any other attributes which Allah loves, this will necessitate Allah عز وجل being with, because he says, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah is with the patient. Now we have a number of verses to this effect. طيب. المبحث الرابع في المعية. Let's finish the مبحث الرابع. The fourth discussion, هل هي حقيقية أو لا? Is it real or not? As we had mentioned earlier. ذكر ذلك وأن من فسرها وأن من السلف من فسرها باللازم وهي الذي لا يكاد يرى الإنسان سواه, ومنهم من قال هي على حقيقتها لكنها معية تليق بالله عز وجل وخاصة به. Among the Salaf are those who have explained it according to the apparent meaning, which is Allah encompassing us in knowledge, seeing, hearing. He said this is what, you know, really comes to mind initially. And others, those who explain it according to its real understanding, but we say it is ma'iyya, which is befitting Allah's majesty. The same we say Allah rising above His throne befits Allah's majesty. Allah's hearing befits Allah's majesty. Allah's face is befitting Allah's majesty. Allah's being with befits Allah's majesty. So the same way we understand the attributes of Allah befitting His greatness and majesty, so do we do with this. Is that clear? I hope so. وهذا صريح كلام المؤلف رحمه الله هنا في هذا الكتاب وغيره. This is the apparent meaning or explanation of Shaykh Al-Sabi ibn Taymiyyah and this book and others. لكن تصانع عن الظنون الكاذبة. But we have to be careful that we do not allow any kind of false lies or false ideas to become present. Where someone says, okay, that means that Allah is with us here, He's everywhere, He's in you, He's out, you know, as some of the Jahmites had indicated. مثل أن يظن أن الله معنا في الأرض ونحو ذلك فإن هذا باطل مستحيل. Like someone claiming that Allah is with us on earth, we say this is falsehood and impossible. Because Allah had explained to us that He is above His creation. Then the Shaykh will go on to explain, are there any contradictions between the transcendency of Allah and Allah being with? But time, inshallah, does not allow us to elaborate much on that. So we will leave it until the next session, bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. And alhamdulillah, this is going to be a very interesting discussion dealing with ma'iyya, which is quite extensive. And then afterwards, inshallah, we'll be dealing with the attribute of speech. Kalam. Allah's speech What do we Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah believe concerning that? Because you have some people who say that Allah does not speak. He does not speak. And the Quran is not the speech of Allah. It is created by Allah. And this is a whole other discussion. So inshallah ta'ala we will deal with it eventually. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك. I apologize for last week.